Finance and Purposes Committee, Monday 23rd of January. This meeting is being recorded for publication on the Thatcham Town Council YouTube channel, although obviously such recording will cease after item 13 so that we can discuss item 14 in the absence of press and public. Do we have any apologies for absence, Madam Deputy Clerk?
Apologies received from Councillor Jeremy Cotton with Councillor Mead Cross substituting.
Thank you very much. Any declarations of interest from everyone?
Richard? Yes, item 9, member of the Warman Insurance Board, and a trustee of Thatcham Memorial Foundation. I'm not appointed or representing the council, so I presume I have to leave the chamber when this item is discussed.
I would think that would be to do so once more. Right. I also am a trustee of the Memorial Foundation, but I am the council representative. I would therefore stay in the discussion. Indeed, actually, the agenda item is for me to update the committee and seek approval. So it'd be fairly silly if I wasn't. But I will hand over the chair to the vice chair, sorry, at that point, i.e. Councillor Lee Gillam. Minutes of the two meetings, 24th October and 12th of December last year. Thank you. Does that find a seconder? Richard, thank you. Anyone wish to make any amendments, suggestions to those minutes? In that case, could I have those in favour of adoption, please? Unanimous, thank you. Any matters arising truly from the previous?
Nothing for me, Chairman.
Any matters arising that aren't covered on the agenda from any members present? No, thank you. Budget review 2023. My apologies, first of all, there is an error on the next item 6B3. It is saying there's an overspend of approximately 18,109. That is actually incorrect. You have, I believe, Marae has given everyone a copy of the revised spreadsheet, which is dated today's date, so 23rd of January. From which you will note, I hope, that the shortfall is actually £5,604. The reason for the discrepancy is actually that 18,109 was a surplus, not a deficit. The staffing increased figure, which is up by £23,713 from the budget figure, has not or was not carried forward into the total. So that made a £23,713 difference. There are also two items which have been subject to transfers from reserves, one from earmarked reserve, and one from the general reserve. The general reserve one being the Family Fund Day, 8,937. And the other one, can you remind me, Mireille, if you recall?
It's from SIL, which is the public conveniences. Of £6,348.
Thank you. That was in respect of the vandal deterrent cisterns, which were replaced. Neither of those were in the first iteration of this document. Jeff?
Well, am I right in saying, Chairman, that that has improved since we were looking at it late in last year? So there is a forecast over 25604, but we're heading in the right direction, Chair?
Marginal, very marginal.
Well, better than the other, I suppose.
A matter of a few hundred pounds only, nothing significant. The largest changes, as I say, are those two substantial changes. So the amount currently being projected that we will need to cover from the general reserves is £5,604. That obviously is not the totality of the shortfall, because the £8,900 for Family Fund Day has already been taken from general reserves. So we're looking at about £14,000-£15,000 projected overspend on cash terms at the moment. That obviously is projected and is subject to change when we get actuals for January, February and March. Are there any questions on that before we move on to reserves?
Mr. Chairman, I mean, it hasn't moved much since we last reviewed it, but also it could have got worse. And as you say, we've got the actuals to come in, but what I'm confident of is through speaking and working with the officers is that real commitment to be, evaluating all of our spend in the last part of this financial year, to make sure that we come in as close to budget as we can. Obviously, with the inflationary pressures we've already had in here, and an increase in staffing costs from the national awards. There are pressures that even we couldn't have foretold when we set this budget over a year ago, and what a financial year it's been in terms of change. So I think the fact that we are carrying an overspend, but one that we can meet from our general reserves, again, shows the importance of having robust reserves and reserve policies so that on occasion we can dip into them to be able to balance the budget back up.
Indeed, thank you. If there's no further questions, we'll move on to the reserves and the 106 SIL money. There is also an updated sheet for you here. Unfortunately, it's on A4 rather than A3. The only change to the SIL and reserve money that you have already had with the paperwork that came out previously is the change to that projected shortfall, which on this A4 sheet is in red on the top right hand corner. So that projected shortfall 5604 now matches the other spreadsheet, 23 page long spreadsheet which you have in front of you. Please
say something. You're fighting small. I think I complained previously about baby size and suddenly getting a bigger one. With or without glasses or whatever appearing, I find it very difficult to follow the figures. Is this something that's up for me? Yeah. Well, we can help.
Sorry.
If there's any immediate questions that you've got, Richard, please shout. I share your pain as far as size of writing goes. To the extent that my PA, when I was working, actually bought me a magnifying glass for my Christmas present. As I say, the only difference on the very small one is that change of the projected shortfall from 18109 to 5604. If there are no questions on SIL, I suggest that we note the report on reserves and SIL money. We'll go into that a little bit later under 6B, which is suggested movements to the earmarked reserves. So we will come back to this item. So happy then to take any more queries if anyone has any on there. I suggest we receive a note, if that finds a second. Thank you, those in favour. Thank you. Right, move on to item six, budget and precept. Again, taking the latest iteration, you will notice that the budget deficit forecast now is 7831, as opposed to the December figure, which was 9490. There have only been three changes, apart from one about 300 quid. There have only been three changes since the last draft budget was before this committee in December. We have actually had the tax base figure in, the number of houses that we have paying precept to the council coffers. That, rather surprisingly, has actually gone up. We were expecting it to go down because people who are in financial difficulty and get council tax relief do not pay us a precept. But it actually has gone up by some 90 houses. Richard.
And may I ask, what is the total number of houses now?
Very good question. I don't have that information for me. It's not actually the total number of houses because it is they're all converted into band D. So if you've got a larger house, it's one point something of a band D equivalent. If you have a smaller house, it's two, it's half or something of a of the band D equivalent. So I'm more than happy to give you a teach-in on preset setting and tax bases
on another occasion.
So the amount, therefore, of the preset with the suggested rise that we had last time of 8.75% has gone up. It's actually gone up by 4,460. There have been two other alterations since the previous budget. We have taken out the £5,000 for coronation, largely because we have no idea what is going to be suggested for the coronation. We have, however, put in £7,500 for the Freedom of the Town, Royal School of Military Survey, and their rights to parade through the town with flags flying and bayonets fixed, I think is the expression. So there is that alteration. The net result of those two is that the... That's all right, no problem. Is that the shortfall on general reserves has come down from 9,490 to 7,831. So it's come down slightly. I would, however, give a caveat to that before we actually think that that is the overall deficit, because the figures include £10,000 coming from Hennick Worthy earmarked reserve to cover what we anticipate to be an increase in the budget call from Hennick, and also £2,000 from earmarked reserves for detached youth. So the actual cash outflow in the coming financial year is projected to be 19,831, just short of 20,000. But of that, only the smaller figure of 7831 will come from general reserves. I don't intend, because we went through the budget line by line last meeting, I don't intend to do that again, purely and simply in terms of time saving, but more than happy, because I'm sure you've been avidly reading every line since you had the figures, more than happy to take any questions that you may have on those figures, Jeff. Sorry, Mr. Mayor. Sorry.
Chairman, we had a lot of pressures and a lot of difficulties to surmount. And I'd like to thank you for all the work you've put in with the officers, with Mary, with Trudy, with the clerk, to get us to this position. Nobody would want to be calling on what I think is a small degree of reserves to balance budgets, but I think we've done a very elegant job of doing that. If there is investment, I'm sure the leader will talk more about that probably at the full council meeting next week. But I do think that the work you do needs to be recognised. Thank you, Chairman.
Thanks. And I reinforce the thanks to the officers for the work that that they do. I have to say one. Oh, sorry.
Lee. You can go first, Mr. Chairman. For me after.
Sorry, is it going?
Okay, no, okay. So I was going to say, if you wanted to finish your...
No, you carry on. Mine's a general point.
Yeah. So the Mayor's correct. I'll address what this budget delivers for Thatcham residents at next week's full council, which is tradition. This being the FNGP committee that makes a recommendation. Again, just to talk on the financial side. So, Councillor Brooks says, you know, it's a small amount of reserves that we're using. But the reason we're doing that is to say that we don't have to ask our residents to pay more. And, you know, in a cost of living crisis that we've got now, it's right that the council does look at its own reserve first, you know, so that when we do ask for any money from residents, they know that we're asking for the right amount to be able to deliver their services, you know, and that we're not putting too much of a burden onto them. And I think the overall recommendation for the bandy of 8.75 increase, you know, is below inflation, which really shows how we're cutting our cloth internally, but still delivering those services. And echo the Mayor's thanks to you and to the team as well.
Thank you. Appreciate that. So the proposal and the draft budget is based on various assumptions which we've seen before. The proposal that I would like to place before FNGP, or this committee, sorry, is that we propose to full council an 8.75 inflationary increase to the Band D tax base. In fact, actually, Richard, the figure is here. The band number of Band D equivalent properties is 9,261.1. Which would give a proposed precept of 885,361. Does that find a seconder? If you give me space. Thank you. I have a seconder. Does anyone wish to talk to that proposal before we take a vote? Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. I was looking through the papers, Chairman, and wondering if those were, you were going to vote on those recommendations. The proposal you just put, is that part of this? Is that additional to this? I'm just trying to get my own bearings in the meeting. And perhaps you could make the proposal again, forgive me, but I just wondered where we were in terms of paperwork. So.
Right. Proposal, the draft budget is based on those assumptions. We will actually on the agenda consider those under point C, 6C, next item down. So it's the service charges for the financial year in line with those assumptions. So if you look at 6C.
Yes, I understand that, sir. Chairman, I'm looking at us agreeing to reduce the newsletter, the hall charges going up. Is that in your proposal you just had seconded, sir?
That was, again, that is part of the overall proposal. I wasn't intending to take those separately, but no, I'm more than happy to do so.
No need, I don't think, Chairman. While I've got the chair, the newsletter reduces to two per year. That's the printed newsletter, and it doesn't stop us doing publications online in between. So I don't think that's a reduction in our communication approach. I just wanted to make sure that people understood that we're making decisions here that are absolutely appropriate. And, you know, no voluntary contribution to Thatcham Library. Without going into too much detail, Chairman, just rehearsing some of the movements we've got here, 10% charge increase on market cemetery allotments. Just so people are clear and probably for the record, Chairman.
Okay, thank you for that. Does anybody have any further points or questions before we take a vote on the recommendations?
Yeah, I was at the library today and been there a couple of times recently. You just update me on the, I do say there's a voluntary payment and we're not making it, but how is this going to pan out in the future? Do you have any policy on this, withholding it forever or withholding it until some event comes to pass?
I'll tool the leader in, if I may, on that point. Yeah, so I mean, this administration's view is that we shouldn't be paying voluntary contributions to a primary authority for what is their statutory service provision. So providing libraries is a responsibility of West Berkshire Council, and West Berkshire Council should fulfil that obligation to its residents. It's as simple as that, really. And I mean, I can go further to say, actually, if it was a Lib Dem controlled administration of West Berkshire, then we wouldn't be making those requests of parish council in the first place. I think it came about by having two administrations of the same colour trying to sort out their paymasters at West Berkshire Council, if I'm brutally honest. I think it was a bad decision to make at the time. And I'm glad that we've been able to finally extract ourselves from a huge contribution in our precept every year, for which it's a statutory service that West Berkshire Council and residents are already paying for when they pay their council tax to WBC.
I'll just add to that, if we were to pay that voluntary contribution, it equates to about 3% increase of our precept. Because as has been demonstrated, we are already in deficit. So we would be putting the precept up by above inflation. Which we didn't wish to do.
How much is the sum? Isn't it
24,000. Thank you. So if there are no other questions on the assumptions and the various sub-decisions that form part of that, we have a proposal and seconder. Those who are in favour, please, of recommending to full council the 8.75 increase to Band D, please show. Those against and those abstaining, one abstention, thank you. We now move to a couple of recommendations to full council on movements of reserves.
I was just going to propose that as per the recommendation, we make those movements. It's a financial accounting issue, isn't it?
We've
got the explanation now of the 3,000, which I know this committee has concerned about, the viability of that money.
Yes. The Henning Worthy transfer, I will just say, this earmark reserve was to cover the replacement for the AstroTurf, the hockey pit, which West Berks very kindly paid for out of their sill money. So we don't have to now have the amount in the earmark reserve. I have suggested, and this is my suggestion, I have suggested that we do retain some money in the earmark reserve for Henningworthy, largely because this year we have financial pressures. Next year we will also have financial pressures. Therefore, to have £20,000 in that earmark reserve, one where we transfer £10,000 over this year, one we can transfer £10,000 over next year when we will continue to have pressures, because that's when the energy bills will rise, apart from anything else, seem to me to be reasonably prudent.
Yeah, well, and we've still got a long-term relationship with the Hemet site, along with them. Just because the asterisk has been paid for from SIL this time, doesn't mean it will be next time. And we tend to have a good lifespan from our features at Henning. They tend to outlast the average for them, which is good. So, you know, we can get like 14 to 16 years, whereas actually manufacturing-wise, it's sort of every 10 years you're looking to replace them. So it's prudent that we keep money there for what, again, is a large revenue cost for us every year. You know, that partnership at Henning. So you're looking at 45k annual spend, plus the budget could change in one particular year. Again, prudent to have a line specifically for him.
Yeah. I think we will have, we always have been slightly in the dark sometimes with the outturn for Henning. It's never actually worked against us until this last year. I know those councillors who are on the joint management committee will be getting a greater handle on the budget for next year. So we will have more advanced notification of what we are likely to be committed to.
And as chairman of the joint management committee, I'll be giving assurances that we should not get surprises. I've shared with you their process of developing that budget, and I'm not worried, but we should not get something we're unsurprising at.
The net effect of the two transfers is to push the working reserve back up. In fact, that will come up to I think another 22, that would take us up to nearly £100,000 on the working reserve, which, as you may recall, I've always said before, I would like to see us keep at least £50,000 for the shops that may or may not come. That then sounds quite a lot. However, I will remind council, as I said last time, we have what I always rather unscientifically refer to as our drop-down dead reserve, which is 220,000, where we have to keep adequate reserves for some of the larger shocks that may occur with the council, you know, helicopter landing on the council roof or some other massively unforeseen contingency. That has not moved for a couple of years. In truth, when inflation was 2%, it didn't really matter. Inflation is now 10%. Therefore, there is probably an expectation that we may have to put 22,000, let's say, of working balance reserve to the reserve that effectively we don't touch. That is down to council to decide, and that will come before full council. I think probably first council meeting of the new term and new civic year and new administration. Plus, of course, we have the shortfall projected from this year that we have to take account of. Plus, as I say, I'm fairly confident that we may well have a shortfall in the following year's budget as well, unless we wish to cut services, which of course is always the other option. So although that working reserve may seem quite high, actually when you look at a position 2 years down the line, it's not, and will be not far away from the 50,000 that I would like to see us keep for prudent purposes. So with that long and involved explanation, thank you. Is that fine, a seconder? Jeff, thank you. Anybody wish to speak to that proposal before we take their vote?
Oh, this is 6B. Please. 6B, is it?
Yeah. This is 6B, yes. Yeah, I'm taking both unless anyone has any wish to split the two, vote for one but not the other. But I shall take both. Are there any other questions or points? No. In that case, could I ask for those in favour to these recommendations to full council, please? Thank you. That is unanimous. Point B, three, as I say, we've covered that already with the overspend. We now come to 6C, which is the service charges for the year. So what we are proposing is 10% increase in the, which is basically inflation, in the market fees, central fees, and allotment charges. Allotment charges have already been dealt with, and a 5% increase in the board charges. There is a working party that is looking at increasing the activity through the halls because Birdwood Centre, especially, is resulting in a loss at the moment. Therefore, we have suggested a smaller increase to the halls pending that review. Lita, did you wish to?
I just wanted to while we're talking about the halls, if I can, Mr. Chairman, just talk about policy rather than finance. The halls play a crucial role, whether it be a community organisation or somewhere that you have your kids' party locally. You know, they span the whole community, actually. And we're really fortunate that we've got a good geographical spread around the town as well. And because of that, you know, that's why we're saying we're not going to increase them in line with inflation. Because it's an important resource for people to be able to use. But also what we're doing, as you said, in terms of the working party, is looking at how customers, in effect, can access the hall booking systems easier. And I'm pleased to say that through the clerk and the officers, we're going to be starting a three-month trial of the electronic booking system for hall matter halls. So that means residents will be able to click online, you know, choose that Saturday afternoon session, 1 till 3, and see if it's available, and if it is, secure the booking there and then. Don't have to wait for the offices to be open on Monday morning. So that drive, that digital offering for customer is part and parcel of this 5% hall charge, which we think together hopefully will then increase the use and the utility of the halls and reduce that budget pressure on us.
Any other comments before we move to a proposal? Could I propose from the chair then that the two sets of service charges under 6A1 and under 6A2 be now I'm not sure whether that's implemented or that is going to full council. That must be implemented by this committee, actually. That's not a recommendation to full council. So can I propose from the chair that we approve those? That's actually the second. Jeff, thank you.
So I wanted to just seek some clarification, if I may.
Please.
That's to increase the service. No, I think, okay, that's right, because it's captured it in the line. Yeah. I was just making sure that FNGP, while I'm increasing the charges from tomorrow. Sorry, I've caught it in the line.
Sorry. Did that find a second? Yes, thank you. Anybody wish to speak before we take the vote? No. Those in favour of approval of those service charge increases, please. Thank you. Unanimous.
Thank you.
And we now come to 6D, Recommendation from the officers to increase the allotment maintenance deposit. I think this came before us and we actually deferred until such time as we were looking at the allotment charges and therefore would increase those for the financial year 23-24, although that is not actually within the body of this, but that would be the proposal that I would be making. Clark, I should have said the outset, Madam Deputy Clerk is very kindly deputising for the clerk. Clerks, therefore, as she is not here, has put a little bit of background information of the costs to clear the plot when the occupancy changes. Does anybody have a view on this? I would certainly be proposing it for the chair in due course. Anyone has a wish to express a view before we move to a proposal?
That's my view. It's sufficient. There's £20 at present. That seems very low. I understand that there's always a few people wanting to get a lot into our plots. So £60 certainly to me doesn't seem excessive, but I want to make sure that it's an appropriate thing now. We don't have to spend increasing it maybe next year or in the interim period. So, any thoughts on that?
Yes, thank you.
Happy and sufficient.
Again, I'll bring the leader to me.
I mean, I think it's a fair comment, Richard, but I think if we're in, an increase from 20 to 60 backed up with an average cost so we can justify that to our allotment holders, I think asking to hold on to a penny more of someone's money at this time is not right. And as said, we've got the data there. I think we have to go with the data and let's review it in a year. I know it might then be put up again, but let's be data led and only ask for the money out of people's pockets that we need to hold.
Yeah. So makes sense. If there's no other pre-vote comments, then I would propose that from the chair, if that finds a seconder.
Seconded, Chair.
Lee, thank you. Anyone wish to speak to that proposal before we open the vote? No, could I ask for those in favour then of increasing the maintenance deposit to £60 per plot? Those in favour, please. Again, unanimous. Thank you. We now move to purchase of equipment. Request from the events manager. I actually know little apart from what is here. I wonder if Mr. Mayor, as chair of the events committee, if you are aware of this and what this will do for us, for the council.
I'm aware it's a good thing to do and it's required, and I support it. I'm not able to go into why this microphone is better than our last microphone, Chairman. And since it's a relatively small amount of money, I think it does assist. We've had more than one occasion, you'll recall, where people have come to an event and said, I wasn't able to hear very well. This doesn't mean that we'll have ghetto blasters everywhere, but it will help the clarity of our public address system, Chairman. And I therefore wholeheartedly support it.
Thank you. Lina?
Yeah, my only comment would be similar to Richard's on the last one, which is it doesn't seem that much money. And so is it going to deliver what we need? Because at Remembrance, and then we did the bench for Jerry, we couldn't hear. At the coronation, people couldn't hear when they were stood by the DC stone, from back there in that direction. And then also you just couldn't hear if you were outside of that main channel, the directional sound as well. But if officers have got into it and made a, they feel this will do it, then great. But I don't want to then go and buy another speaker because you're doubling the price. Whereas if you get a better speaker now, it's only a third of the price extra.
Yeah. I'll just ask the deputy clerk whether she's aware of anything.
I'm not right.
I take the point entirely. I'm not anywhere near an audio specialist. I'm being advised by our staff. If you want more information on this, in terms of options, think about that. We could have done this. We're choosing to do this. I'd suggest deferring it. And would the events committee meeting on February the 6th be able to sign this off? Or is it just an FMGP thing? Because what I'm saying is Mr. Sackett will be here then. He could give us what he's looked at, other options. We may decide for an extra couple of hundred quid, there's a better solution. So it addresses the committee without waiting to come back to FMGP in 2 months' time.
Thank you. Lynn?
Yeah, so I was going to ask Mr. Chairman if we could pass a motion delegate the limit spend. So if we said up to £1,000 and then subject also to Councillor Pike reviewing that document, because he is a sound and theatre specialist. So let's use the knowledge of members while we've got it.
I would actually absolutely agree that is a sensible solution. Two things I would say. I think this is the portable PA system, which is used predominantly, I believe, for the things which are on the small stage at the far end of the Broadway, and things like the declaration of accession of King Charles, etc. So it's not going to affect the larger ones. It won't affect Christmas lights, and I don't think necessarily it would do anything for remembrance, apart from potentially the additional speaker. But I don't know.
For Remembrance Day rather than Sunday, yeah. So Armistice Day rather than Remembrance Sunday, yeah. We use the in-house systems, and that didn't work.
I'm happy to follow the leader and the mayor's suggestion. I would however make one amendment. As we have seen, nice to haves are going to be looked at fairly closely next year. As indeed we have done for probably the last 2 years. Therefore, more than happy for that amount of delegation to be, say, £250. Personally, I would struggle with £1,000, because we are taking that out of rolling capital, but I'm happy to have people argue with me.
Well, I mean, I don't know what can we give to £250 or an extra £12, you know, or whatever gets us in equipment. I didn't want to slow down the decision-making process. And it's something that's been raised with me by people. And it's even in my own frustration being at events and not being able to hear properly, you don't get the enjoyment of the event. We spend all this officer time putting the events on, you know, and it's really discouraging just because of the communication issue that some residents find that it wasn't as involved because they couldn't hear.
Could you live with 500, Chairman?
Negotiation on the hoof.
Absolutely.
I would propose an amendment to the leader's proposal then at 500 rather than 1,000 to delegate to the events committee the decision on the equipment to purchase, if the leader is prepared to accept that.
I'd like to second the proposed amendment to the amendment.
So that is a proposal as amended and as seconded. Anybody wish to make any other comments before we go to the vote? No. All those in favour, please, of delegation. Thank you. Item 8, Thatcham Youth. We have received notification that, unfortunately, the roller disco will be closing. I think this has been going for quite a long time. Councillor Lister, anything to add as representative on Thatcham Youth?
I think a
noting item. Obviously, the Thatcham Youth will give their annual written report to
full council in March and presented to meeting in April. Leader?
Yeah, just could we ask when they produce that report, just a bit of a financial breakdown of how much of the roller skating cost to put on and what are they going to reappropriate those funds for?
Mm.
You know, how are they going to plug that gap? Or they might come back with a reduced ask of us because of that as well. But it'd be good to get that in the annual report.
Yeah, absolutely. Any other comments on this? We will merely receive it if there are no other comments. Right, duly received. Thank you. War Memorial Insurance Grant. This is the point in time when I ask, or not ask, but.
Musical jazz around here.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so item 9 is regarding the War Memorial Insurance Grant. Councillor Cole, would you like to give us an update?
Thank you, Chair. This is a situation where the committee was asking for information that having spent about an hour and a half with the member of the Memorial Foundation, they cannot give. We were asking for 3 quotes for insurance broker. We were asking for 3 quotes for the War Memorial revaluation. We were asking for 3 quotes for the actual premium itself. The War Memorial is pretty specialist. There was only, I believe, 1 quote that Mill Foundation were actually able to obtain from someone who would conceivably do the work. So the revaluation was done in the back of essentially 1 quote for renewing the work. The 3 insurance brokers. 2 insurance brokers were considered last time the insurance broker was changed, which I believe is 2-3 years ago. Now Bess in Reading, and again, that was the standout in terms of quality of service, previous insurance broker having not been particularly fit for purpose. That is the quote that the insurance broker managed to obtain. Again, not everyone understands an insurance company not wishing to insure a memorial foundation. So having spent and say about an hour and a half looking through emails in the company of and guided by the chairman of the Memorial Foundation, I am satisfied purely personally that we couldn't get what this committee is actually asking for. And I'm also satisfied as I can be that the quote is either reasonable or we can't obtain additional quotes elsewhere, and that the amount of the rebuild cost is based upon a quote where there aren't alternative quotes available. So up to the committee what they wish to do, but frankly, you ain't going to get any more information because there isn't any more information there or available.
So just one from me and I'll come around the room. The clerk had said to us before that we weren't aware of the revaluation going ahead. So they've changed provider, insurance provider now.
I don't know the answer to that. That was the quote that was obtained by the insurance broker. So the Memorial Foundation do not arrange their own insurances. They go to a broker who arranges it for them.
And then we pay the premium for that here.
Thank you. And I think my points are more to help anybody watching from home. Because what we're agreeing here is to pay, is it directly? It doesn't matter really, but this £777 is in case the war memorial were destroyed and had to be rebuilt. Have we got that right? Because we're using language in here, which we all understand, but people tuning in, or one of them, perhaps, but hopefully more, would understand. Have I got that right? It's that we're paying a premium of £777 a year if that memorial were destroyed, damaged, graffitiized. That's what it's for.
Yeah, it's a war memorial, exactly, out insurance for the actual physical war memorial.
And if a
lorry comes off the A4 and crashes into it.
But we haven't had any damage in the last 10, 12 years or so.
Just minor vandalism that gets picked up. Okay. You know,
but the risk is there, as you say, it's on the A4. So just to be clear, that's what we're saying.
Yeah, thank you.
Did you want to come back in here, Councillor Cole?
No, I was going to say I believe that also encompasses extraordinary wear and tear, which may be
frost damage,
something that is not normal wear and tear.
Mm-hmm. Councillor Jeffrey.
Thank you. Proper comments, please. Thank you very much indeed, Councillor Cole, for giving us the explanations to where things happened, which being a member of the committee in the past, I know that a lot of work is a deep one into making sure that everything now is working in a proper professional way. So I'm really genuinely reassured from that school. But one comment that I have heard in the past is, why should the town council be paying this particular insurance premium or subsidising and paying for it? And the answer to that in my book is, yes, it is indeed that memorial is indeed our memorial, is on the memorial land, but it is the memorial from the town of Thatcham, the people of Thatcham, for those that served and died in two world wars. And I think that is the reason why we should be paying it. And the fact that it's gone up dramatically on this particular year, yes, it's a shame. Yes, it happens. But I think it's still our moral responsibility to be funding it. So I think that in terms of process, I think it's been handled properly. And in terms of the principle of whether we should be funding the insurance, I think we absolutely should be.
Yeah, thank you. And Councillor Carter.
Thank you, Chair. I reiterate Owen's comment. This is not the first thing that has been subject to an increased premium or increased costs, purely and simply because the professionalism of the foundation has increased dramatically. There were no safety reports being done at one stage many years ago. There were no HR policies. There are all sorts of policies, not to mention the finances, which I was closely involved with. And inevitably, when you start doing things properly, that occasionally throws up increases in costs.
Okay, I mean, I think the comment I would say is that when any of our partners are doing something that might end up costing us more, is to have that early engagement with us. For example, we've got a monument in the town hall, in the town centre, the Millennium Monument, which I'm imagining is insured. You know, it's the same as the war memorial when it comes, you know, in terms of a structural piece of work there. And also, you know, could we, you know, bring it into our estate and manage it or insure it directly through us? You know, there are options that you could consider in that. And so I just ask again for all of our partners, particularly when we have been minded to fund it since 2011, that we don't get stung, you know, with a bill that's over our budget position as well. You know, our budget was 450, so there was a prudent uplift in it, and you know, this is almost doubling it. Councillor Foster.
I've got a question and clarification on that.
Please.
Councillor Curry talked about the cost of the work, and we're talking about insurance here. Is this imaginary work that might have to be done if there was damage to the model? Or is there some real work that does have to be done on the roadmap?
Yeah, please.
If I may, Chair, no, it is unforeseen damage to it's not something that we know the war memorial will have to be replaced at some point in time, because stone work never lasts forever. Even stone never lasts forever. That is a separate conversation that I think the foundation and this council have to have. Because that will inevitably come up at some point in time. But no, this is purely insurance for unforeseen.
Which case, I just find it incredibly high sum of money, because it's sort of comparable to what I pay annually for my house insurance. So if we're saying, and my house, you know, several hundred thousand pounds worth of are we saying that the cost of replacing the wall is similar to the cost of building one of our houses? It just seems horrible. Is the risk so much higher of damage to it? Because that's what it's a combination of cost and risk, isn't it? Or is the risk so much higher that that's what puts the cost up?
I would suspect there's a combination of both, because if you have to replace the wall more, then it's going to be handcrafted. And that's never going to come cheap, is it? I mean, I'd expect it would cost 150,000, to do something like that and carve the names back into it and stuff.
The quote that actually was came out is 130,095.
I start the business of building more than okay. Well, I think we've had debate on it. I mean, I think the three options, to be honest with you, are yes, no, or is there some questions that members still want answering? And is the monument, our own town council monument, just worth exploring? The costs there. And again, maybe we do it that subject to those checks, we approve it, because this has come to this committee now a couple of times. But again, we don't want to be slow in our decision making for no reason. But I just wonder, is it just worth a check with our insurers around the monument, get that price comparison, and just to see. And then if it is, great, we can do that. And if not, we go down this route. It is the town's memorial, as Councillor Jeffrey pointed out. So, you know, we use it for our Armistice Day. You know, we lead that parade. So it's right that, you know, the council should pay for it.
I would just point out, Chair, in terms of reputation, the Memorial Foundation, I believe, paid the premium in July of last year, and it has been on their books ever since.
Okay, so only come to us last FNGP and this one.
I think it was a discussion that was taking place between the town clerk and the chairman of the Memorial Foundation before it even came to FNGP first time round.
I think reputational risk sits with the Memorial Trust taking on a cost before it's come to its partner, to be honest with you, rather than this council.
I think given we're in a period that's been insured, I would suggest we agree this charge for 1 year, and we take on board what you said, Chairman, in terms of looking at our estate and seeing if there's a different insurer. In June, July of this year, which would satisfy the short-term pressure and the longer-term consideration of whether that's the best way of doing it. Yeah.
Chairman, I would second that if that were a proposal from that.
Just a, what did we budget for next financial year? For the member.
Very good question, Chair.
I don't know.
Why are you saving?
I think I know where to find it. If
Aaron Cossack,
the financial manager.
Unchained well. Need to update it, don't we?
Okay.
£850, Chair.
Okay, good. Okay, so we have a proposal from Councillor Brooks. It's been seconded by Councillor Jeffrey. Anyone want to talk to that proposal?
Just to say, Chair, I will be abstaining.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. Okay, all those in favour? Thank you. Good. We move on to item 10. I'll hand the chair back to the chairman and I'll go and get Councillor Crumley.
Chair, I
see you, Temporary.
The agenda. Leader, have you stolen my agenda?
No.
Oh.
Yes.
Obviously, I know this inside out, backwards, and backwards. Easy. Financials. Tax payments. First one, 10.1, headed list of purchase ledger payments. If we flip through these, please shout if you have any queries on any item. So we will go page one, page two, page three. Owen.
Two pages, I may or three, perhaps two, thanks, healing time. What is that? Is the other bit still at the inspections? Is this actually the supply of a piece of equipment? And quite frankly, if that perhaps can be answered with an email later on.
I was going to suggest
I do have the invoice here, and it's not clear on the invoice. It does say falling tunnel assembly, £1,300. And the fixing pack for the crawling tunnel is £55. And then, activity equipment supply, £425.
This may be part of it. That is for the inspection of the wall.
Oh, it's not a gate. It's in church gate. Yes.
Yeah, it's the church gate wall.
Yes.
Which is another pressure that we have because that assessment of the wall has indicated that there is potentially some significant repair work which is required. Basically the pressure of all the dead people who've built up the level of the churchyard in the past
So that is a substantial potential headwind that we also have, which needs to be met and mastered, as they say.
Whilst on some walls, the other wall, which I thought was referred to, running along the footpath that runs to the north side of the churchyard, that presumably is, that's not our responsibility, and that now the priory, and the priory is still our responsibility. Does that mean
that's as I understand it? In fact, I'm not even sure where the problems that wall are. I think they relate to the houses rather than the priory itself, because we did some considerable work to anchor that the wall. There's a large, rather unattractive bracing in the garden of the priory. So I suspect that is actually the houses. In fact, I'm pretty sure this has come before council before. And we found out that it was the houses rather than the priory. It's not our responsibility anyway. If there are no queries on page 3, we are on page 4. That's the single item on page 5. If there are no other queries, I would propose that we receive and approve those. Is that fine? Seconder, thank you. Unless there's any comments, those in favour, thank you. Now we'll move on to 10.2. These are the pre-authorised payments made from the Imprest account using the debit card, usually very small amounts of items. Again, we'll flip down these, but Owen?
Proposed to receive them out.
Thank you.
Please
do.
Partway down, 24th of October, Peninsula Technical Services, £3,900 for employment services. What is that, please?
Peninsula are our HR advisors.
What were they doing for £4,000?
I can answer that. That invoice was, we paid them by direct debit. So that invoice went through in error. And they now have slides of the credit note, which you'll see going through shortly. So they reduced that amount. And in the end, it cost £400 on the £34,000. So, but that was taken up, and we'll see now.
We haven't got it back yet.
I'm impressed, Richard.
Yeah. another
yeah,
one.
Please do. You're on the roll.
In August and September of various, say, 28,000 in September, but by November. It's 33,034. Well, quite a jump. I'm afraid I would expect it to be about the same each month.
In November,
there
was some
backdated
payments that were included.
Well, the news came to November, backdated to August or something like that.
Yeah.
Any other queries on the list of payments? Please.
This is on page 2. This is 30th November. That was compressed £2,500 for top of Bart's account.
That happens regularly. The Bart's account is the bank account that the town clerk runs for smaller purchases, and it's topped up to an interest value of £2,500 every month.
Like a petty cash account?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I can call it a petty cash account rather than the Sparks account.
It's used really to repay deposits and the like. So it's an account that the clerk bears full responsibility for. So we do still help out. Solid on the cash debit card as well.
Yeah, I think there's a, the clerk can still have that when we call it the money box or whatever. I think what we're saying is that members, we'd like it to not seem that it's the clerk's person.
Right, okay. Yes,
that's a suitable word in the navy.
Yes.
You could even cruise the cruise line.
Where is the clerk this week?
Yes,
yes, it's true. So there's 2,500 top up machines in the state, yeah.
Okay. And it's due to be topped up again next.
I wish to point out for the record, we are not casting any aspersions about the clerk, that's a joke.
the Wi-Fi dodgy.
Any more questions on the current accounts list of payments? The thank you. Find the seconder. Thank you. Those in favour. Thank you. Soldo account. Soldo credit.
So proposed.
Prepaid. No. Okay.
Proposed.
On the seconder. Thank you. Any comments before we go to the vote or any questions? No. Those in favour, please, then. Thank you. Now move on.
That all of the value are the same, apart from the credit card deposit, which has gone out by a couple of pounds. 407.50 in the amount. The receipt's not on bank statement 196. That's that variation.
That's interest that we agree because we received the bank statement because of the postage stroke. So once the bank statements come through,
yeah. That will be zero. Okay, thank you. So that's reconciliation 10.3. Essentially, where our money is. Thank you. Any questions for you on the vote? Those in favour of adoption, please. I'll see what the motions are. Thank you. Unanimous. H, creditor report. If there are any questions on here, we would have to go into part two as a comprises sensitive third party information. But if there are no questions on the creditor report, is that for the second? Thank you. Any questions, queries? No, those in favour, then please. Thank you. And moving to the aged debtor. Report again, not for publication.
So proposed chair looks very neat and tidy.
Thank you. Document seconded. Thank you. Any queries written? We will have to stop recording. Could I propose that we ask press and public to withdraw? Thank you. Those in favour. Thank you. We will temporarily stop recording. We now come to reports from town council employees.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
Did we vote in favour?
We did. We did. Thank you. Town council employees, appointees. Richard, anything on Green and Common?
I'm watching the time in this meeting. So which is bad because our next meeting, maybe quarterly, is actually on Thursday this week. So their last meeting was in October, and I don't think that I was there for that. But I don't think anything significant arose that would interest this group. I can't be at the meeting on Thursday. I suppose I could offer other councillors the opportunity to attend. Position with anybody who's interested to do that, but I don't know of anything that's going to come up for this particular contentious
Okay.
I mean, for most of what they talked about last time was allowing the fun run on Christmas Day and when the people come around with a dog on the lead. The horse needs cutting, which doesn't concern them.
Thank you.
Do we need to check with Tom just on their rules, if you can have a say, for example? So maybe if we have a look at it, I mean, put an email out for members would be my suggestion.
I think there's certainly no, I mean, Councillor Pike has attended just as a member of the public in the past. So certainly somebody could attend, but if they want to attend in that position,
but it could be asked to depth start female members, and then if someone comes forward, let the trucks know as well in advance of them attending. The depth can give all members, can't they?
Homestart West Parks has just had a meeting with Tri-Tend. Again, nothing particularly contentious. Their number of families that they support has reduced. I think that's partly because of the difficulty in getting volunteers. But the number in Thatcham is about 43. That hasn't reduced. So as a percentage, I think it's now a third of their total where it was before. When it means about 43 families in Thatcham that were going to support them.
Thank you.
Nothing new to report except the name, which changed on monthly. I don't know why it has to reappear as the National Society, because it should say touch and support our welfare society. And that was changed.
Thank you. Volunteer Bureau, Ellen, do we have anything from
anywhere? No meeting attended since our last meeting, but I'm advised there's a meeting in the next week or so, and she will attend, so next time.
Thank you. Setting you, Stavians.
Sorry, Chairman, no meetings reports, and the lots of the agenda.
Thank you.
Do we have anything
from the suicide prevention? Moving on to recommendation from the Community Engagement Working Party, agenda item 12. You have the paper in front of you. Councillor Nettycrop has very kindly come along to talk to this particular item. The floor is yours, sir.
Thank you. So going back a few years, when I first joined the council and involved with the library, there was a request for more town guides, which were normally kept in plentiful supply in the library and handed out to those visiting the town or coming into the library for reference information, trying to find out about various organisations, that kind of thing. And also at the time there were issues with the previous publisher, and that the 2017 version wouldn't be replaced. More recently, the town clerk has had information on the proposed guide. And the organisation publishing it basically do their own commercial business in the background, getting funding for ads and so on. And what they provide to the town council is a new town guide every 2 to 3 years. They provide 5,000 copies of the printed version and not can be purchased, but there's a corresponding online version as well. And we have the ability to basically build the content for that guide. And it seems a bit of a no-brainer, really. There's no direct cost to us unless we opt for a £400 feature article. I'd probably need to clarify that slightly, because
You've been town councillor, have recently gone through the same route, and just reading through it, you get the impression it doesn't quite have the town council's ownership. And I don't know whether you can clarify as to whether, when they say a feature article, whether they're saying basically a town council introduction to the guide. Mm-hmm. Because although we provide the content for it, we can say that we want a list of those organisations there and a bit of history there and a town map there. Mm-hmm. Whether it's if we want to basically put like a mayor's photo in introduction, welcome to our guide, whether that comes under that feature category. So I think it'd be worth clarifying that. With that proviso, I think it seems to be a very easy way for us to provide a town guide going forward for those visiting the town, for estate agents, anybody else that needs to share that content with people in the town.
Thanks, Mark. I looked at the Newbury one. It was on the financial debt.
Yeah,
page turning by clicking on the appropriate bit, and it was very well put together, I thought.
Mm-hmm.
Very well set out, designed, good quality photos, etc. Any comments, Mr. Mayor?
I'm always keen to promote the town and the council services through publication like this. There's a budget for it within a general communication budget, and I don't know whether we've lost or forgotten the previous one to have a look at it, although it may be very different because a new publisher's involved. But I'm in favour of promoting ourselves in it, Chairman, 5,000 of them going around the town plus online. But a question as well, what's the deadline for our copy? Because, that needs to go through our own process of drawing it up.
So there's 12 weeks lead time, I believe. It would seem a good opportunity, I suppose, to set it up now and have it ready for the finishing touches to be included when the new administration is in place and it can be brought up to date at that point. And then it would basically be there for the first 2 to 3 years of the next council.
Yeah, my only thing with the printed ones is, as you said, they're printed and they're meant to last for a few years and stuff obviously changes.
Mm-hmm.
That they're really good in year one, year two they're okay, and in year three, pubs and restaurants have changed and shops have come and gone and different services have started up again. But I mean, look, this is no cost to the town council unless we want to make a page out within it ourselves. So I think we should accept the recommendation of curing the guides. Once just check with officers on budgets. So if we were to take the 400, where would that come from?
That would come from general working reserve. We don't have
there's a back office over there, isn't there? And there's,
I think the costs have already been added to the next year's budget, they've been included in, just to give it a holistic view.
Included in what budget? Sorry, I know in our own, but what budget?
Oh, right, okay.
Well, Mary's looking at that. Can I come back, Chairman? Because on the second page, the town clerk has physical copies of the three published guides. It will be available in the meeting. And they definitely be fast. Oh, whoops. Well, they are.
Do you have a link on the centre meeting?
I don't think it's vital for this meeting.
Is it this one, do you think?
But the community engagement working body will probably look at that channel.
Mm-hmm. There they are. Yeah.
Okay.
That's the difference.
Last question, the Newbury ones, the chair thought was so good. Are the same people are going to be preparing our guide with this one?
Yes. Same people.
Yeah.
Same price.
That's a pricey of the actual guide itself is.
Yeah, the guide is about 20 pages.
Yeah, it's a 32 page average. That's
I think there's two aspects to it. One is the commission of the town guide, and the other one is whether the town council wishes to take the feature. I'm taking the vibe from Councillor Lillycrop that perhaps a little bit more information required on the latter. So maybe I'll take those as two different proposals.
Chairman, I was going to say, let's go forward with the town council feature, but double checking that it is something that we can actually write. If it means feature where they scratch their heads and say, cool, well, you do it with extract is a part of Thatcham circuit, but it's not the whole of Thatcham. So I suppose in the context of what you just said, I suppose I am saying, yes, please, let's go ahead with taking the brief charge element. And perhaps indeed, we just need to get the part to get a little bit more information about what is involved. Is it something that we can write ourselves, or is it going to be written by them or the other part as an editorial or whatever? The town council reach.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I was just thinking maybe put it the other way around, that if we can agree to the 400 and then go into the detail, and if that cost can be avoided because we're preparing the content and we're happy with the content as it stands, and we avoid £400 charge, then we do that.
Second, Mr. Chairman.
Would committee be happy if that were delegated to the committee engaged with working party?
Yes.
In that case, proposal what we
not content, Chair.
Decision on whether to go ahead, and then then we've got to decide who actually does the content. The content, I guess, would come to either here or possibly even full council for sign off. Any views?
Full council, because the town council guide, but most of it's going to be information and officer led, and then a bit of a statement over the top.
Okay. Right, so we have a proposal for supporting the recommendation for commissioning the town guide. And also to examine the what we would get for the £400 delegated to the community engagement working party to make a decision on that element, with content to be agreed by full council. Is that sum the proposal up, leader? If I could have an indication of whether there's a second of that proposal. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Anybody wish to make any comments before we go to vote? No, those in favour of the proposal, please. Unanimous. Thank you. May I propose that in view of the commercial sensitive nature of business to be transacted under the next item, is visible public interest, but present public be temporarily excluded and they are instructed to withdraw. Does that find a seconder? Those in favour? Thank you. Right. Recommendation again.